In this video, I'm going to show you how to make a black flame. There's no trick here. Like, I haven't inverted the colors or anything like that. The explanation for how it works is really cool. And along the way, we'll learn one weird trick that glassblowers use to make fire invisible. So I did say that there was no trick photography in this footage, but actually the fact that it's black and white is sort of a trick. If I put it back to full color and then turn off the auto white balance on my camera, you'll see that everything's very yellow. That's because I'm illuminating the scene with one of these old-fashioned street lights called a sodium street light. Sodium street lights were used for a long time because they're incredibly efficient. Unfortunately, sodium street lights make everything look weird. Like, you know, there's this number, the CRI, for a light bulb, and it tells you how good is this light source at making colors look the way they are naturally. Sunlight has a CRI of 100, and a light source that doesn't allow you to distinguish color at all would have a CRI of 0. And, well, sodium streetlights have a CRI of 0. But what makes them so bad at rendering color is also the thing that turns this flame black. You might know this already, but if you excite an atom in the right way, an electron will jump up to a higher orbital. And when it drops back down again, it releases a photon of light. How much energy the photon has is just the difference between the two energy levels. The electron is giving up some of the energy it had up here, and it's throwing it away in the form of a photon. But because these orbitals are quantized, their energy levels are fixed, which means the energy of a photon released by that transition will always be the same. And the energy of a photon defines its color. And for sodium, there's only really one possible transition that exists within the visible spectrum, which gives off photons with about a third of a femtojoule of energy. And they have this yellow-orange color. You don't normally talk about the femtojoules of a photon, by the way. You usually talk about the wavelength, in this case, 590 nanometers. It's actually quite unusual for an element to only have one strong visible line like this. For example, I've got some xenon gas in this vial, and when I excite it with electricity via this tiny Tesla coil, you get this lovely color. To see what that color is made of, I could use a prism in the same way that Newton used a prism to find out that sunlight was made up of the full spectrum of colors. Instead of a prism, though, I'll use a diffraction grating. You see how it splits sunlight into a rainbow, just like a prism, when I put it in front of the lens of my camera. Putting the diffraction grating in front of the xenon shows us that although it looks white, it's actually made up of lots of discrete lines instead of the full spectrum. Compare that to sodium, which has just the one line. I keep saying that sodium has just one line, but that's not strictly true. There are in fact two emission lines very close together. We just can't distinguish it with this setup. I'll get to that later though, because I really want to explain this black flame thing first. So an atom of sodium emits a very specific color of photon when an electron drops from the 3p orbital to the 3s orbital. But the opposite also happens. If you can hit a sodium atom with a photon that has just the right energy, the electron will jump from the 3s orbital to the 3p orbital, absorbing that photon. If the photon has too little energy, the sodium atom won't absorb it. But also, if it's got too much energy, the sodium atom won't absorb it either. So as well as having an emission spectrum, sodium also has an absorption spectrum, which is just the inverse of the emission spectrum. And with that simple fact, we can explain the black flame. So there are at least two ways to excite sodium atoms so that they give off orange light. The sodium street lamp uses electricity, which, when you get down to it, is actually about collisions. Electrons streaming from the anode to the cathode smack into those sodium atoms, and that's what causes the jump in energy levels. The other way to do it is with heat. So I start off with a methanol flame. The reason I'm choosing methanol is because it burns with an almost invisible fire. I actually don't want any light from the fire itself, because now I add a bit of salt water. The heat from the fire vaporizes the sodium in the salt and excites it at the same time. It causes the valence electron to jump up. And when it drops back down, it releases that orange photon, which is why the flame is orange. So all the time in that flame, you've got a mixture of excited sodium and sodium in the ground state. And it's those ground state sodium atoms that make the trick work. Because remember, those ground state sodium atoms are really good at absorbing 590 nanometer photons, which is the exact photons that are being produced by the sodium streetlight. And of course, if the flame is absorbing photons, it's going to look dark. And that's normally the end of the explanation, but I think it's important to clear up two things. The first question you might have is like, okay, the flame is absorbing photons from the lamp, but it's also producing photons of its own. In normal lighting conditions, you can see that this flame is producing lots of light. So don't these two things cancel out? Well, the answer to that is that my sodium streetlight is just a lot brighter than the flame, so the tiny amount of light produced by the flame itself is pretty negligible. But the more important question that you might have is this: after a sodium atom has absorbed one of the orange photons from the streetlight, it's just going to re-emit it again almost straight away. So if one photon is emitted for every photon that's absorbed, it shouldn't look black at all. But let's think about what you're actually seeing here. To the left of the flame, you can see the white wall behind it is well illuminated with that orange light. The fact that you can see the wall means that those orange photons are traveling from the wall into your eyes, or in this case, into the lens of my camera. The bit of wall behind the flame is also well illuminated by the sodium streetlight. But when the photons leaving the wall begin their journey into my camera lens, they have to pass through the flame. And when they do, they get absorbed by the sodium atoms in the flame. And yes, for every photon that's absorbed, a new photon is emitted. But crucially, the newly emitted photon will be traveling in a completely random direction. The chance that it will be pointing towards the camera lens is very low. In other words, the light from the wall behind the flame is scattered in all directions, leaving a dark patch behind. All this reminds me of something really cool that my friend Andrea Seller showed me. These special glasses worn by glass blowers. They do something amazing and I wanted to see it in action. So I went to visit the glass blower at University College London. John here is working a piece of glass with a blowtorch. And because the glass has a bit of sodium in it, as the temperature goes up, eventually some of that sodium starts to vaporize and we see that characteristic orange light. Eventually it gets so bright that it's hard for John to see what he's doing. But look what happens when I put this special pair of glasses in front of my camera lens. Isn't that amazing? It completely blocks that orange light and suddenly John can see what he's working with. While I was running tests on the glassblower glasses for this video, I realized that I now have the equipment that I need to run tests on these EnChroma glasses that I've had lying around for years. I've wanted to run the tests for a long time because when I heard about them, I was skeptical. Like, they claim to enhance color vision for people with red-green color blindness. But how can something that removes light help someone to see colors that they don't have the anatomy for? So we're going to test whether the way these work matches the way EnChroma says they work. Wait, if EnChroma can sell these, I bet I could sell these. Are there still some old sodium streetlights where you live? Do you hate the color? Would you rather see nothing at all? Then you should try Enmoldia glasses. They'll completely cut out that horrible orange glow. Don't use while driving at night. Don't use while walking at night. That's the advert sorted. Ah, I'm gonna need a website. I know, I'll use the sponsor of this video, Odoo. That way, the website will be free for life, including e-commerce with a free personalized domain name for 1 year. Odoo isn't just websites and e-commerce though. It's an all-in-one management software for entrepreneurs, including business management tools like invoicing, accounting, project management, inventory, etc., etc. So the first app, like e-commerce plus website, is free for life, and that includes unlimited hosting and support. And if you want to add any other standalone apps, you switch to the paid plan. So look, here's the four-step process for getting the website up and running. Define your goals, choose your color palette, insert your own logo, add pages and features, and choose your theme. That's the structure of the website ready to go. Then you can customize it. You don't need technical skills, it's drag and drop. You can change the typography, colors, all sorts of stuff. And the grid system just makes it all look nice so that it works on desktop and mobile. And if you're short of inspiration, ChatGTP is built right in for generating parts of the text. Check out the link in the description to try out Odoo for yourself. Right, so to figure out what these pairs of glasses are doing to the spectrum, we need to make some improvements to this setup that I showed you earlier, where I was putting a diffraction grating in front of my camera. And that's exactly what this is for. There's some kind of webcam at the end of this tube, and at the other end you've got the slit, and there's a diffraction grating in there somewhere too. And you can point that slit at anything you want to find the spectrum of. And it really is just a webcam. Look, I can switch from my built-in laptop webcam to this one. I might actually use this for Zoom meetings, you know. But with some special software, I can focus in on just the spectrum part of the image. And from that, it spits out a graph. When I point it at the sodium streetlight, you can see there's the 590 nanometers. nanometers. This is much more precise than I was doing before, but you still can't see two individual peaks. This device has a resolution of about plus or minus 2 nanometers of wavelength, but the two sodium peaks are about 0.6 nanometers apart. There's another little peak in the infrared, which I believe is also coming from sodium, but it's weirdly hard to fact check that. There are also little peaks either side of the main peak, which I believe are also coming from sodium, but people don't talk about them because, well, they're so much weaker than the main peak. The reason the webcam inside this device can see infrared and a bit of ultraviolet is because, well, all webcams can. It's just most of them have a filter to block those parts out, but that filter was removed from the webcam inside this device. Look, this is Chris Wesley removing the filter before putting it into one of his devices. It's a great bit of kit, by the way. Like, you could spend maybe £1,000 on a similarly capable spectrometer, but this one, made from 3D printed parts and a modified webcam and a cardboard tube, is less than £200. If you're interested, there's a link to Chris's website in the description. I did have a go with this spectrometer at UCL, and you can kind of see a doublet there. The reason there are two lines instead of one, by the way, is because of electron spin. So you might know that electrons have this property called spin. It's not like spin in the classical sense of something spinning around, because an electron is a point-like particle. How can something that's one-dimensional have spin? Doesn't make sense. But it is like spin in the classical sense of it gives the electron angular momentum. And by the way, that's my new favorite profound and weird fact about the universe. How can a point-like particle have angular momentum? This angular momentum turns the electron into a magnet, and because it's quantized, that magnet is either pointing upwards or downwards. That's the spin up and spin down that you might have heard of. And that causes them to have subtly different energy levels. But that never made sense to me, because, like, they're just the mirror image of each other. How can one have more energy than the other? And it turns out it's to do with the orbitals. Like, you know how a moon can be going around a planet like that, and the moon can be spinning either in the same direction, so they're both spinning clockwise, that's prograde spin, or it can be spinning in the opposite direction to the orbit, that's retrograde spin. And the same goes for atoms. An orbital can have angular momentum in one direction or the other, which creates another magnet, and that magnet is either in the same direction as the electron spin magnet, or it's in the opposite direction. If it's in the opposite direction, they're attracted to each other more strongly, and that changes the energy levels. And that's how you get the split. Okay, so now let's shine sunlight into this thing. That dip in the infrared, by the way, is the signature of oxygen. So we know that the oxygen in the atmosphere must be absorbing some of that wavelength from the sunlight that's hitting the Earth. I wouldn't see that dip if I was doing this experiment in the vacuum of space, because I'd be dead. And look, if I put the glass blower glasses in front, there's that dip in just exactly the right spot for the sodium line. That notch is achieved by the addition of neodymium and praseodymium to the glasses. The absorption spectrum of those elements nicely cut out the sodium line. It's also cutting out some of the green there. I think that's just some different transitions of neodymium and praseodymium. Here's something I don't understand, though. Like, in the black flame experiment, we're seeing that sodium will absorb the sodium line. So why do glass blowers use neodymium and praseodymium? Why not just put a load of sodium in the glasses? Shouldn't that be good at absorbing the orange light? Well, it turns out that sodium only emits 590 nanometer light when it's in gas form. When sodium is bound up in glass, its emission and absorption spectrums are different, which makes sense because those valence electrons are going to be involved in the bonding somehow. But neodymium and praseodymium are different. They're lanthanides. And it turns out that the orbitals of the valence electrons in lanthanides are actually relatively small compared to the orbitals that are already full. In other words, they're kind of hidden away from what's going on around them. So the absorption spectrum of neodymium and praseodymium are unaffected by whether it's in a gas form or whether it's bonded to something else or whether it's part of a larger solid. So finally, we get to the question of EnChroma glasses. What do these glasses do to the spectrum of light entering them? So if I point my spectrometer at sunlight and then put the EnChroma glasses in front, this is what we see. So this is interesting. You've got this notch here. And actually, that does correspond with the claims of EnChroma. The logic goes like this. The most common type of color blindness comes from the sensitivity of the red cones and the green cones overlapping too much. So if most of the confusion happens around the peak of those absorptions where they're really overlapping, you can cut out that peak with special glasses. Then maybe your red and green cones can distinguish between what's left on either side. This particular pair are for outdoor use, so they're also lowering everything, like a pair of shades would. So the glasses are doing what they claim to be doing in terms of their mode of operation. But whether they help colorblind people to see colors that they couldn't before is another question. I actually don't want to comment on that too much, and that's for two reasons. The first is, it's a weirdly polarized topic now, and I don't like being shouted at. But the other reason is, the published literature on the subject doesn't seem particularly conclusive. If I had to summarize the literature, it would probably be that there is no evidence that they help with colorblind tests, though it does seem like that's because certain tests it helps you to be able to perceive, but at the same time there are other tests that it stops you being able to perceive. So overall, you don't have an improvement on those tests. Part of the reason for the polarization around EnChroma glasses, I think, is because of their dubious marketing practices. When these arrived, there was a little note with them suggesting that I should film the reaction of the person they were intended for and then post it to social media. But then, of course, you're going to have a publication bias, aren't you? I filmed my nephew using these and they didn't really have an effect. So, of course, I didn't post the video anywhere. That was about 4 years ago, by the way, and that particular nephew now has a YouTube channel of his own. If you're even vaguely interested in Gorilla Tag, I highly recommend it. Link in the card in the description. EnChroma don't claim that these glasses work for all colorblind people. And of course, it's not just about passing colorblindness tests, which the literature seems to be focused on. It's about your experience. Of course, it's worth the money if when you put them on, they make you happier by that amount of money. So you could go to an optician, some opticians sell these, you could try them. And if they pass the happiness versus money test and you don't care about their dubious marketing practices and you don't care whether they make you happier than a placebo pair of shades under clinical testing conditions, then maybe EnChroma glasses are for you. But EnMoldia glasses, well, they're for everyone. God, that's a good ending to the video, isn't it? It's a shame that I'm going to carry on going because there's one more thing that I want to tell you. It's this really cool fact about Bunsen burners. What we've been doing in this video is spectroscopy, and it's the method by which loads of new elements were discovered back in the day. Robert Bunsen was one of the scientists using that technique, and he would heat his elements with a flame. So, like me, he needed a flame that produced hardly any light of its own, because that obscures the results. To do that, he needed a burner that would mix oxygen into the gas supply before it was lit. In other words, that twiddly thing at the bottom of a Bunsen burner was put there to help us find new elements.